Namaskar. I am sitting on a wheelchair in front of you because I have a C7 quadriplegic. I'm a C7 quadriplegic, which means my neck is broken high up here, and beneath my neck, my body is dead. No movement, no sensation. The reckless driving of one person shattered many families and left my granny, two of my aunties dead, and me on a wheelchair. I moved from hospitals to rehab centers one after the other, until finally I had to tell myself that my body is dead. I am going to be dependent on a wheelchair, but I can lead a near normal life. I can do almost everything, maybe a little differently, maybe at a slower pace. But when I reached Bhubaneswar, society and government made me acutely aware of the fact that I was different. I was disabled and I did not belong. For some time, there was a lot of confusion. I could not understand that I was the same achiever, that same loving heart, that same rational mind. Why is everybody rejecting me? And at one point of time, I almost gave up, but for my parents and my siblings who forced me to take charge of my life. It impacted me very badly, the disability. But of the three impacts it had, the minimum was my loss of privacy. Even for my very basic needs, intimate needs like my bladder care, my bowel care, changing my sanitary napkins, my underclothes, I was always to be dependent on someone. But this I adjusted very, very easily. What impacted me more was social rejection. My marriage broke down. Every time I went out to see a cinema, to the restaurant, I got tired of people staring at me and sometimes giving very rude remarks. Like one day, a bunch of youngsters in Keshari Cinema Hall said, "Why these people come and jam the corridors? They should be better off at their homes." Or in Puri, in Sri Jagannath Temple, when I expressed my desire to go inside, the priest said, "How many sins you have committed in your past life? You're on a wheelchair this life. Once again, you want to go inside on this chair and commit more sins." All this was so unacceptable. And then, of course, the railway journey, when the TTE told me, if you have a berth in the first floor, upper berth, you have to go there. And I spent the night in front of the toilet corridor. Or the aircraft. Every time I entered the airport, I had to continuously keep talking to the crew and to the fellow passengers that disability was not contagious, that I was not going to cause any kind of a mid-air scare. But that which impacted me the most was loss of jobs, not once, but many times. First, they did not allow me to join the Indian bureaucracy and offered me a reduced rank and a pay, which I refused. And then with great difficulty, I went back to the university to complete a PhD so that I can get into academics. It was challenging, I can tell you, because lab was in the first floor. I was in the ground floor and somebody had to lift me all the way to the lab and bring me down. And in such a, it was very new experience, my disability. I was learning, my bladder training was going on, and I would be wet. My clothes would be wet. I was so embarrassed, I wanted to give up, but for a family which kept pushing me and said, "No, we will find solutions." So that night, my mother cuts out old towels, makes thick pads so that I can go back to the university and not feel embarrassed when I'm wet. With these difficulties also, I got a PhD and a National Young Scientist Award and was all ready to join a job. But what happens? First job, I know I'm the best. So many gold medals, National Young Scientist Award, a 3 times national debating champion, a Chancellor's Cup winner. Yes, this job is mine because I have done very well in my interview. The result comes out, I'm second. The second interview, 3 positions, I'm 4th. The third, for a research position, 7 positions, I'm 7th. That's when I understood that my wheelchair, it had become so huge, so big, that people did not look beyond it. And then I told my father I want to commit a suicide, to which he said, that's an option we will explore later. Right now, let us concentrate on what you can do. You have to take hold of your life. Take hold of my life? I did not want to exist. Invisible, uncared for. What should I do? What was necessary was to change the notions of incapability and asexuality associated to disability. It was necessary for governments to go beyond distributing wheelchairs, hearing aids, and sympathetic attitudes to understand people as human beings with rights. It was necessary for society to look beyond the wheels, the white canes, the hearing aids, and look at that loving heart and that rational mind and that smart brain. But change doesn't come easily. You need to work for it step by step. Step by step, with a lot of patience, brings about significant changes. So what did I do? I started looking at the facts staring at me. And what were these facts? Can we go back, please? The 3 realities that were looking at me, staring at me, is people with disabilities were superheroes or supervillains. In their own families, they were invisible and people did not look at them. And what does government do? It looks at people with disabilities as objects who needed care, distribute wheelchairs, distribute hearing aids, give them this, give them that. But nobody wanted to talk about the larger things in life. Give education, give employment, bring them to the mainstream of society, talk about accessibility. And these changes started. When I say I am not the only one, but I do know me and a couple of friends in India, we have been the forerunner in bringing about changes in this country. What did we do and what are the tools we use? The first thing that I did was become self-employed. Someone who had qualified the Indian Civil Services, I started with tuitions. I was teaching children of class 5 and 6, 7 and 8, housewives, then civil servant aspirants, and here I was earning something. So happy to share with you, I have over 300 students who are placed in India in different services. So happy to also share with you, the same institution which once rejected me, did not allow me to join the bureaucracy. Today in Labasna, they invite me to address the probationers and talk to them about creating an equal society. Then what do? I read. I make myself knowledgeable. Every scrap of information I read. And I know that what is happening in Western countries, people with disabilities are being respected for their knowledge, their skills, their capacity. So there was hope. How do I translate this hope in India to a reality? Next, I start traveling. I traveled extensively across Odisha, across Bhubaneswar, across India, across the world, learning, understanding, appreciating. And I'll just share one horror story of Odisha with you. In one house, a mother who has a hyperactive child is told by the neighbors to tie the child, as when she goes out to work, he disturbs everybody. So she ties him because she's a single mother. And one evening she comes back to see rats eating her children. I meet mothers of deaf girls who keep on telling me the girls are abused by close family relatives, but she has to tell her children, please be quiet. These are the people who are going to take care of a future. This was such a dismal situation. It just hurt me deep inside. Change was needed. It was very essential to consider people with disabilities as human beings first. Their needs as that of human beings of basic education, basic employment, and living a life of decency. So what do? I networked. I became member of Disabled People's International, Commonwealth Disabled Forum. I was part of National Committee on Rights of Persons with Disability, National Disability Network. I was traveling, I was meeting people, I was understanding how to bring about change. And the one thing that became very clear is small steps. Small steps done continuously over the years bring about change. So what were my two small steps? One was advocacy and second was awareness. Continuously, every state of government, every government officer I started writing to, I would go outside, learn, come and share the information with the chief secretaries, secretary of women and child development, because that was the department which dealt with disability. And when I went to the other departments, education, sports, officer after officer told me, why are you coming to us? You people with disability should go to your department. And this thought needed change. So I kept on writing. We did many other things. We did dharnas, we did protests, we did candle march, we did media workshops, continuous writing, research, creating data, and then working on it was one of the major tools that we used. So today, our legacy. In 1987, when I lost my job, it was because there was no law to fight for me. There was no law to protect my rights. But continuous advocacy, continuously meeting people, writing articles, doing small researches, meeting government officers, sending information to other people who did not have it. What happens? Today, we have 5 strong laws in this country, and the mother of all laws, Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act 2016, for the first time, accepting people with disability in this country, in India, as people, as human beings who have rights. Considering a child with disability as child first, a youth with disability as a youth first, and a woman with disability as a woman first. And this RPWD Act, I'm so proud of it, because this law was made by people with disabilities like me, by parents who have children with disabilities, by experts who have talked and researched on disability. I would like to remind you about one thing. If you remember December 2016, the parliament was completely held quiet. No law, nothing got passed because opposition and government didn't get together. I cannot tell you how many tweets we did, how many emails we wrote. We approached every member of the parliament, and do you know our achievement? In 2016 December, the only law that got passed in India was the law for Rights of Persons with Disabilities 2016. I must tell you about CRPD, the Convention on Rights of Persons with Disabilities. In 2000, when I was in the UN, when I was in US, and we were talking about the Convention for Children, Convention on Women, we were asking questions to the United Nations. Where is the Convention for Rights of Persons with Disability? Why every country after country is looking at disability as a welfare issue, as a charity issue? It took several years. From 1998, the continuous working of civil society organizations around the world, and in 2006, we got the first Convention on Rights of Persons with Disability, which changed the paradigm of disability. The entire world spoke in one language, and that is of human rights. No more charity, no more social model, no more welfare. It's only about rights and human rights. The Accessible India campaign, and I will start it with a story. This campaign, when we celebrated the first International Day for Persons with Disability in Bhuvaneshwar, I went to an auditorium called as Jaydev Bhavan, where they were celebrating the day. When I walk in, the officers, the people come running. Come, we will lift your wheelchair inside. I said, no, this is my day. How could you be so insensitive as to be asking to lift me up the stairs? Didn't you sit and plan? As this discussion was going on, in walks the then commissioner of the department, Mr. Chinmay Basu. So these people start to push me away. I said, no, don't do that. Then he comes close to me and he asks me, what is the matter? I said, you are a senior officer and you did not have the sensitivity to build a ramp for my dignity? What about the other people with disabilities? Why are you carrying them inside? He said, give me 45 minutes. When I returned back after 45 minutes, the first ramp of India was built in Jaydev Bhavan, which is in Bhuvaneshwar in Odisha. And today, in 2019, the first accessible campaign was rolled out by the Prime Minister in the year 2015. the senses. After getting our first law, when we rushed to the planning department that we were to be given, why isn't there a budget allocation for us? What is happening? We were told, you are a minuscule number in the census. First get yourself counted in census. When we rushed to census office, the then Mr. Banthia was the census commissioner, and he said, there is no time. This is 2000. The counting will be in 2001. Who is going to train the enumerators to count you? We went through a protest, a dharna. We sat in front of his office with kerosene that we are going to douse ourselves unless you count us. After a lot of negotiations, lot of dharna, lot of media attraction, finally the then Home Minister, Mr. Rajnath Singh, invited us for a discussion, and the first time in independent India in 2001, it was decided that people with disabilities must be counted. This was a huge achievement, because only after we were counted was a proper budget allotted for people with disabilities. Coming to Accessible India campaign, many of you must be knowing that 2019 elections were based on the theme of accessibility for all. This was again a long, long journey which started in 2004. We were writing letters to everybody. In 2001, when I went to cast my vote, the room was very narrow. There were thresholds everywhere. The tables were very close and the ballot box was low. I could not cast my vote. And because of the delay for making arrangements for me, not only the polling officers, but my fellow people, my fellow Indian citizen were also unhappy. And when I came out, I heard them saying, ah, one vote of hers, what change is it going to make? That humiliation channelized into constructive anger and positive action. Consistent advocacy, 2019 election was accessible election in India. And finally coming to the SDGs, this move we started in 1996. When the MDGs were being framed, no one talked about disability. But in 2015, we were ready. We were doing consistent advocacy. And when sustainable development goals were decided by the United Nations, I hope most of you know about the SDGs. These are goals which have been developed that the whole world will march together. It is a truth that if you leave a significant population behind, how will development happen? How will India develop if its people with disabilities are not part of its development process? So in 2015, when the new goals were developed, when it was decided that in 2030 it will be counted, how the world is progressing on extreme poverty, on education, the theme was taken, leave no one behind. And five of the goals are explicitly inclusive goals, which talk about education, inclusive education, talk about employment, inclusive and decent employment, talk about smart city and all the sustainable cities, sustainable, accessible cities with uniform design. This has been achieved not by one person, but I'm very happy. I have been part of a journey where I was unfavorably rejected from the system because of a disability over which I had no control. But I am happy through small steps, consistent steps, I have not been able to change my life only, but I have been able to bring about a huge change in this country. Acceptance from being an object of welfare to a human being with rights. Thank you for a patient hearing.